Calvin Trenberth, next to James Hansen, has been instrumental to forge computer model-centric forecasting for the man-made global warming. Would you like to know what Trenberth had done in his climate research? Welcome to Jung Tuition. I am Jung. Let's continue discussing basic issues in weather and climate research. Today, we are going to have a close-up of Trenberth to see how he explained the discrepancies between the computer-simulated Earth Energy Imbalance, EEI, and the rate of the change in the ocean heat content, or OHC. Are you ready? Let's go and have fun. In 2013, Trenberth was invited to give a presentation at Yale University to brief the state-of-art climate modeling and implications. Half of the audience are economists. So we're going to see how he performed in this talk.
So looking at one method now, looking at CCSM4, which it was commented before, is actually a pretty good model. And here we've run the model 8 times.
Notice, since EEI cannot be measured reliably, the EEI he used was computer simulated.
Then the one standard deviation monthly values, then you can see the fluctuations in here. So this is natural variability that is occurring within this model from one run to the next. The El Niños occur at different times.
No, it's not. The natural variability is much higher, plus minus 4 watt per meter square, as acknowledged by Graham Stevens. You can see the mean EEI was almost zero before 1960 and gradually increased to almost positive 0.9 watt per meter square. Remember this number, please.
And this is the record of the ocean heat content from the ECMWF reanalysis. And what I want to highlight here is the fact that for the first time in an ocean heat content record, we're actually seeing signatures of the 3 major volcanic eruptions that have occurred in this period.
The signature he referred to is the period of cooling after each major volcanic eruptions and even an El Niño, during which OHC kept decreasing for over 1 year because the wind made the sea surface as cool as a cucumber. Can such signatures be explained by the dips used in the simulated energy imbalance? To demonstrate this point, Trenberth used the rate of the change in OHC, or the first derivative of the time-dependent OHC, which is the net heat flux into the ocean at the sea surface.
Given the state of the observing system at that time, this is pretty remarkable agreement, I think, between these two things.
Of course, if you simply used his poorly prepared diagram, you might think he's right. At least, the position of the model dips for the volcanic eruptions. However, if you look at this well-prepared diagram by myself of the same information content, you can certainly find many differences between the two things. Obviously, the rate of OHC oscillates widely and madly.
This is not an easy thing to do. And if you do this with most of the ocean heat content records that exist from other sources, you will find that they're all over the place with incredible amounts of noise.
That also should be the case in instrumentally observed EEI, the energy imbalance signal at the top of the atmosphere, with uncertainty close to plus minus 4 watt per meter square, as discussed in my previous talk. However, this is not the case for the simulated EEI he used. During the Echinchung volcanic eruption, for example, the rate of OHC first drops to the negative minimum, then rebounds to the positive maximum, and continues oscillating. But the simulated EEI does not. For Pinatubo, the rate of OHC first dropped to a negative value determined by the slope as shown in this diagram, and stayed for 1.5 years before it oscillated around the zero. By way of contrast, however, the deep fall pinatubo merely touched the negative 3 watts per meter squared and immediately returned to the illuminated mean EEI.
1998 was the warmest year in the 20th century. It was a time when the ocean was cooling. The energy imbalance at the top of the atmosphere was negative. So there's some rules, there's some things associated with this. We've actually got the warmest year on record at a time when the planet is actually cooling.
You see, Trenberth appeared puzzled by this natural and normal phenomenon, namely the faster the evaporation of the seawater, the more outgoing long-wave radiation to space would be. That's how Earth regulates the EEI spontaneously. It seems very likely that Trenberth and the other climate researchers can hardly understand the difference between a dynamic balance and a static one at the top of the atmosphere and at the surface of Earth. Do you remember this cartoon I drew last year? The pre-industrial CO2 concentration in the atmosphere has been regarded as a perfect constant for Earth to achieve a zero imbalance. In nature, nevertheless, it is impossible to expect the imbalance, or EEI, is always a positive number.
Here, the energy imbalance is sort of set to 0.8 watts per square meter, which is designed to fit with the ocean heat content. So the ocean.
Did you hear what he said? The EEI is designed, fabricated, to fit with the ocean heat content. As I revealed in my previous talk, the positive constant 0.8 watt per meter square for the EEI was demanded by James Hansen and implemented by Norman Lobb in all post-2019 series products. This implies that all series data published after 2019 are not the original instrumentally observed. Return to his talk. In this diagram, an adjusted series EEI curve was used to replace the illuminated EEI. Still, the phases of the EEI and the rate of OHC curves are actually opposite, except for the year 2007. In addition, after 2008, the fabricated series EEI became totally different from the calculated first derivative of OHC. Also, Trenberth didn't mention the in situ argo data around 2005. As you can see, it's close to negative 2 watt per meter square, nearly 3 watt per meter square, lower than the adjusted series EEI.
Here, I would say there's not great agreement between these two things. We published an article on this.
He had to admit that.
2010, and both of these records, the series record, the ocean heat content records, have been revised, and they've found about 20%. In other words, they've both come together a little bit.
This is cheating. Why don't you keep measuring them?
I think they still have to come together a little bit more, but this is sort of the state of the art in terms of the energy imbalance.
To justify your hypothesis?
So there's not great agreement between these. At times, there are some marked discrepancies.
Unbelievable. And he told his audience that the discrepancy might disappear one day by reanalysis. By the way, it would appear that none of the computer simulation and data analysis or reanalysis used in his talk were done by himself. He merely acted as a salesman to promote the terrible product. What do you think? Thank you for watching. Thank you for support. Have a nice week. See you next time.